Jacob, in this session, I would like to show you how easy it is to use the APIs from within PowerCLI. To start off with, let's have a look at an old-fashioned flowchart that shows you where and how you can use these APIs. When you're automating or scripting, most of the time it starts with a question for data or you have to do something in the environment. Since you're using PowerCLI, your first question will be, is there a commandlet for this? If there is, you're a happy bunny and you can continue with your script. If you're not sure if there's a commandlet, there's always the community and other resources where you can ask. Perhaps they can help you. If you find something, again, you're a happy bunny. But if you're not, it's worth your while to have a look at the APIs. Is there a public API for what you're trying to do? If there isn't, you can ask yourself, am I sure? Did I look at everything? Again, go to the community, ask your colleagues, ask your peers. If you found it, again, continue with the APIs. If you didn't find it, have a look if there's a command at the command line. If there is, you can have a look if there's a possibility to enable SSH. If there isn't, you're in bad luck. There is still a way out here. You can always ask or launch an idea at the PowerCLI ideas site. Now, if you're allowed to do SSH, you can see or check how you can establish or run the command with the parameters you want. And again, you succeed in what you wanted to do. Now, if you have to go to the APIs, there's a double choice at the moment. There are SOAP APIs and there are REST APIs. SOAP APIs are the older ones. They were there from day one. REST APIs are quite new. They were introduced in 6.5 officially. Now, if you go for the SOAP APIs, you have two options in PowerCLI to use them. There's the getView commandlet, and there's the extension data property in most, or if not all, objects that are returned by PowerCLI commandlets. If you have to go to the REST APIs, and that is primarily because it's a newer feature that is only available in REST APIs, you have to ask yourself, how do I want to use these? Do I go the PowerShell way, and then I call that the raw way, then you have two commandlets that can help you. There's an invoke web request and invoke REST method. But there's also the so-called three commandlet modules that come with PowerCLI. With those, you can just call a service, which makes it a lot easier to consume those REST APIs. In this session, we will concentrate primarily on the API Explorer, and then the three ways, as we indicated in this flowchart, how you can use APIs. Since it is important to have good documentation when you're using the APIs, I compiled this page with links to the important documentation that you can use. There is this new website, which is currently still in beta, that contains links to all the API references that we're going to discuss in this session. First of all, there's the Web Services API, which are the old SOAP-based APIs, and there's the automation API, which are the REST APIs. If you open the SOAP API or the Web Services API, it's important or interesting to always have a look on the home page, because that contains the what's new in that release. If you want to find out what new things you could use, have a look, definitely have a look at this page when there's a new version coming out. For the REST API reference, it starts with an introduction and the important point that you need to be authenticated before you can actually use these REST APIs. Further on, the Web Services reference explains how everything is linked together in a vSphere environment. There's this famous service instance from which everything is linked and that you can use to find objects, but also service managers that are available. Besides the introduction of the authentication, the REST API contains entries for all the important components that are available. You can zoom in and look on specific services and which kind of web operation get put and so on that you can execute on these REST APIs. If you link or zoom in, you find details how to call them, and you find details on which parameters you should pass. For using the APIs, it is important that you understand there are two types of objects available. First of all, there's the .NET objects. These are the objects that are returned by your PowerCLI commandlet. They contain many properties and methods, and they are hierarchical, meaning a property can hide or sit before another complex object. vSphere objects also have quite a bit of properties and methods, and again, they are hierarchical. Note that it is important when you use getView with the filter parameter that the right-hand side operator is a regular expression, so take good care how you compose that string. As you can see, there's again an hierarchical structure here where a property can hide another object with complex properties in it. Note that you don't only need to use getView, you can also use the extension data property to reach those same vSphere objects. What is also nice is that you can use both combined in one script. As you can see here, we have two calculated properties, one using a .NET object and another calculated property using a vSphere object. We can use PowerShell to show that objects, the vSphere objects returned by getView and the object sitting behind the extension data property are identical by using the compare object commandlet. As you can see here, the result indicates that both objects are completely the same. vSphere internally is based on pointers from one object to another object. These are called managed object references, or MoRefs in short. In this example, we're looking through getView to find all the ESXi nodes in our environment. Then we use the VM property on those host system objects to find all the VMs running on each specific ESXi node. But we can also use it in another direction. Each of these host systems has a parent property with points in the hierarchy upward. And we can use that structure to go up in the tree structure to find the data center on which this host system is running. So in this example, we see how we can use pointers, MoRefs, in both directions to find information about our environment. In the beginning of this session, one of the reasons we gave why you would look into the APIs was that you want to retrieve data that is not readily available through a commandlet. In this case, we're going to look at the scheduled tasks in your vCenter. There is no real commandlet to obtain that information, but we can easily access the information through the APIs. First, we have to make a call through the scheduled task manager, which is a managed service that's available in vSphere. If you look in the API reference, you'll find the scheduled task manager. And from there, we can descend seeing that it contains a list of all the scheduled tasks. If we look in detail at the scheduled task, we see that there's a property info, which hides, again, a lot of more extra information. That information we can now easily extract in a script. First, we get the scheduled task manager. Then from there, with get view, we get all the scheduled tasks. Remember, the scheduled task manager only contains the motors, the pointers. So we have to use get view to obtain the actual objects. Once we have the actual object, we can, in calculated properties, show all that information from our script. Next to properties, there are the methods that we have on these vSphere objects. In this case, we're going to look at a method consolidate virtual disk that you can't call directly from a PowerCLI command. As you can see, this is a method that doesn't require any parameters, so it's quite easy to invoke this on a virtual machine object. And it is quite easy to now do this for all VMs that would require disk consolidation. We use an aware object clause to filter out the ones that would need a consolidation, and then we call the consolidation on that one. Another new feature that is available since vSphere 6.7 as you can see here in the reference, is to clear triggered alarms. Now these triggered alarms, we can filter them, the ones we want to clear. If you look at the filter itself, it can be based on the type, or it can be based on the trigger in this case. As you can see here in this test environment, we triggered a couple of alarms, some in the red status, some in the yellow status. This to show you how you can use this filter. In this case, we're only going to clear the yellow alarms. If we now look, refresh our web client, we see that all the yellow alarms are indeed cleared. If we don't use a filter or use all the defaults on that filter object, we clear all the alarms that are there. Again, we clear the web client and we see that all the alarms are now indeed gone. When you're working with APIs, things don't always go as you would like them to go, and sometimes you encounter errors. Now, since we are using these APIs through PowerCLI, sometimes PowerCLI hides the real reason why things go wrong. And in that case, it is useful to have a look at the logs available on your vCenter. In this case, we're using a vCenter. Now, instead of always logging onto your VCSA, opening the log, scrolling to where you have to be, I thought it would be a good idea to have a script that does this for me. Looking at the script here, first of all, I look at the current setting, how the logging is done. There are multiple levels there. We save the old level and change it to verbose, meaning we have more messages in the log. Then we make sure that we can connect to the vCenter. And then you insert your code. Notice how we have a start and a finish on both sides of your code. We're going to use that later to extract that part of the log that we actually need. In this case, I'm making a call to a rather new method, change password, to change the password of a local user. As you can see, this was introduced in API 672. It's quite straightforward how it is called. You give the user, you give the old password and the new password. In this case, we're going to make an error on purpose, just to show you how we can find back what goes wrong. So with the start and the finish time, we can now go into the VCSA, access the VPXD log, and with some streaming editor magic, we can extract that part that we actually need. Now watch out, if your VCSA is quite busy in a bigger environment, for example, you might have to put a sleep before you take the finish variable. It could take a while before the data is actually dumped into the log. That's your experience, and you have to find out what is the ideal value for you there. So now that we have that log extract, we're going to set back the original setting for the logging. And then we are showing the output. Now, if we run this, we notice that in this case, there is a good error being returned by PowerCLI. But the point here is that in this last line of the VPXD extract, we see what went wrong here. We see this fault invalid logon, and that is in fact what we are looking for. This would help us, and we know that the old password that we passed is not the correct one. Now let's have a look at the REST APIs. The REST APIs, whenever you want to call those, you have to start off with authentication. Since we're first looking at the raw method, that means with the two native PowerShell commands, we'll start off with the invoke web request. Remember, invoke web request returns most of the object that it receives from the web server back to you. It doesn't do any interpretation or doesn't change any of the data. So we can do a lot of the testing ourselves once the call comes back. But first, let's have a look at the API itself. It's quite simple. We pass the credentials in a predefined format, and we get back a token that we then have to use in any subsequent call to the REST API. With the web request, this looks like this. See how on the reply there is a property status code that we can verify to see if everything works correctly. If status code is not equal to OK, then authentication failed and we have had an issue with the credentials that we passed. Let's do a run. As you can see in that last second to last line, we receive a token that we now have to use in subsequent calls. But once we passed to PowerShell 6, things became a bit easier. As you can see, there's now an authentication parameter that we can use on the invoke web request, which does this translation to base64 for us, which we had to do ourselves in the previous call. Now it is done by the commandlet itself. Again, when we call this, we see that we get a token back that we can use in subsequent calls. The invoke REST method is a bit more complicated. It does a lot of the interpretation for you. It does a lot of the conversion for you. But it has two handy parameters that we can use. Now note that these are only available in PowerShell 7. There is this status code, status variable that we can define in which we can test the return code from the call. And there is this option to bypass any checking so we can interpret the raw return code. And if we call this, again, we get back a token to be used later in any other REST API calls. Now that we have authentication out of the way, we can start doing actual REST API calls. This first example will retrieve from the VCSA the status of its health. It's a very straightforward call. There are no parameters as we can see here. We just have to make sure that we pass the token we receive from the authentication. Also notice how we use that URL from the documentation in our call here. Second important part is the method that we're using, and this time we're using a GET method to retrieve information from the REST server. When we make the call, we get one line back. System health is green in this case. We can also do more complex calls with parameters. In this case, we're going to list all the data centers that are in our environment. If we look at the API call, it's again a GET, but there's a parameter that we could use. There's a filter that we could pass on the call to the REST API. In this case, we're going to work without the filter. We're coming back to that filter later on. So when we call it, the REST API, we get a list back with all the data centers in our environment. In this case, there are two of them. It goes without question that you can combine these REST APIs. So we had this previous result where we obtained a list of all the data centers. We can now go list all the VMs per data center. So if you look at the parameter, again, the list VM also has a filter parameter. But this case, we are going to use it. If you look in the details of such a filter, one of the options we can use is data center, where we can give one or more data center names on which we want to filter. In this case, we're going to look through all the data centers from the previous call and use each of them one by one on the filter for the list VM. This returns us a list of all the VMs plus the data center they belong to. It goes without saying that we can use these REST APIs also from the three commanded modules. In fact, those modules contain three commands, a connect and a disconnect and a get services. With that get services, we obtain the actual object on which we are going to call methods that are the same or which will in turn call those REST APIs. Let's have a look at an example here. In this case, we're going to look at the list VM commandlet. Notice which part of the URL that is listed here we're going to use to filter out the actual service that we want on the get services. Once we have that object returned by get service, we can use it to call the list method. And with that list method, we get a full list of all the VMs plus properties. And it goes without saying that we can use those similar methods, of course, to create objects. In this case, we're looking at creating a local account in our environment. Again, have a look at the URL that is defined here and how we're going to use it on our GET service to get back the actual object on which we are going to make the call. We have to pass some parameters in this case. The user full name, password, and so on. When we make that call, we get the status code telling us that things went okay. And if we look on our VCSA, we see that we have this user code 2020 created as a local account on the VCSA. This concludes the short session on Power CLI and the art of the API. I hope I have triggered some interest in using the APIs from within your Power CLI scripts. Some takeaways from the session I think are interesting and important. First of all, API are complementary to PowerShell, Power CLI. They are not something standing on its own. You use them together. Second, and people might disagree with me on that one, API are not hard once you get the hang of them. And how do you get the hang of them? That's what the third takeaway that I would like to communicate. That is practice, practice, practice. The more you try, the more you fail, the more you write, the better you will get at using the APIs from within your Power CLI, PowerShell scripts. Enjoy.
Cool. Well, thank you, Luke. I see he's active on chat. Luke, I'm going to unmute you if you want to just give a few final words to guests. And just, let's see.
Oh, wait a minute. Is it, am I coming through?
Yes.
Okay. Then I'll just answer to that last question I see in the Q&A there. PowerShell 5.1 or PowerShell 7, like always, it depends. If you're in an environment that is purely Windows, then you probably have equal validity to use 5.1 or 7 as far as I'm concerned. In fact, they can be run side by side. Some features are new in 7, so yes, it's always nice to use the latest version. If you're more of a mixed shop, and if you're using containers, a bigger percentage of Linux boxes, then you would definitely need to concentrate on the 7, the core version, to run your production.
Cool. Thank you. I'm just seeing a lot of questions about whether these sessions will be recorded. They did get recorded, and Luke's question was also in the recording as well. So as long as we get your permission, Luke, we'll be able to post this on YouTube so people who either want to rewatch or miss the session will be able to.
Okay, great. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah. So I think that's going to wrap it up. Our next session is starting a minute ago, actually. So yeah, thank you to everyone. I sent a survey in the chat also. If you have a few seconds, that'd be really appreciated. But otherwise, hope to see you all on the sessions today.
Thank you.
Thank you.